What's going on, guys? Balkan Architect here, and in today's video I'm going to be sharing with you the 5 most common Revit mistakes that I see people make. Now, I see sometimes beginners making these mistakes, but I also see people that are more advanced and they have a bit more knowledge about the software still making these dumb beginner mistakes. And the problem with this isn't really that it's only going to slow you down, but the bigger problem is it can cause trouble for you later on along the road when you're maybe working on some important projects in some big company, and then you mess something up, and then later on everybody finds out that you made the mistake. So in this video I'm going to be sharing those 5 mistakes so you don't make them. Now, just a quick tip before we get into that, I would just like to ask you to like this video. It helps me out a lot with the YouTube algorithm. It promotes the video, and also if you haven't already, I suggest you subscribe. I make multiple useful Revit tutorials each week. Okay, so let's get into the 5 mistakes. So the mistake number 1 that I see people making all the time is not having their own template. Now, if you're working in a company, then of course you're probably going to have a company template, but also I see sometimes companies not having their own templates. So each time they start a new project, they have to kind of create their new walls or load new walls from old projects, load new families. This is especially for perhaps doing, I don't know, curtain walls. And I always keep using a curtain wall door, but it's not in the like the regular template, so you have to load it in. So each time you start a project, you load it in. So it's a hassle, it's a waste of time. So make sure you create your own template and include all of the families and both the system families like walls and roofs, things like that. Create your own layers, but also your component families like doors, windows, I don't know, components, whatever. All of those families, make sure you load them all in inside of your template, and then use that template for a future project. Also your title blocks, things like that. So having your own template, it's going to save you a lot of time. And I see people going and starting over from a regular project, regular default template that comes with Revit, and they do it all the time, and it's a waste of time. So that's the tip number 1, use a template. Okay, or the common mistake that people make is not using the template. Okay, let's move to the common mistake number 2, and that's naming. So many times I have seen people sending me projects and talking about projects, and the project is named like Project 1, or they have some families inserted and the family is called Family 1 or Family 2. Now, that's super annoying. You shouldn't do it. It's going to cause you a lot of trouble later on. Especially if you maybe if you load in a family that's called Family 1, and then you decide to make some changes to that family, and then you kind of save it and name it correctly and load it back into the project, your project is going to have the Family 1 that you loaded in first, and then the new family once you renamed it. So you're just adding additional families that you don't really need. So make sure you name your projects, make sure you name your families, make sure you name any additional stuff that you make, your views, things like that. But also one thing that I also see people make a mistake with naming is something that I sometimes do when I'm in a hurry, and that's renaming things. So for example, let me show you something here. So if I just move on to Revit, and for example, here you have something like, let's say this roof, and if we select the roof, it's a 400 millimeter roof. Now, let's say you want to kind of make it a bit different. Let's say you want a 300 millimeter roof. So what do? You go here into edit type, and then you go into structure, and you just rename it 300, or you just change the thickness to 300, you click OK, apply, OK, and there you go. So it's smaller, but it's still called 400 millimeter. So I do this all the time when I'm in a hurry on some simple projects, but if I were working in a larger company, and for example somebody made a schedule with this roof, and they would buy a roof that's 300 millimeters thick instead of a 400 millimeters thick instead of the 300 millimeters thick that's in the project. So make sure, let me just go back here a couple of times. Okay, so whenever you're making a change like that, make sure you go into edit type, and then just take the extra time, go to duplicate, and then create a new type that's a 300 millimeter roof in this case, and then you go ahead here and change the thickness. So just make sure you rename the families and duplicate families. Don't just use the same ones and change the thickness without changing the name. That's a stupid mistake. Okay, let's move on. The third mistake is using a lot of non-Revit native geometry. So when you're using families, loading in some families from various websites where you can find families, people tend to load in families that are not modeled in Revit. So let me show you here on the example of this 3D tree that we have. So this is a wonderful 3D tree. I really like it. It looks really cool, especially when it's rendered, especially when it has a bit of shading. So it really looks cool, and as you can see, each leaf has been modeled, so that's why it looks so amazing. And I love using this family, but it slows Revit down so much. So if you're just using it to make it look pretty, then yeah, use some families like this. But if you're working on a large project and you want to work fast, then I suggest you don't use these families. Now, one of the ways that you can find out is a family, Revit native family. You can select it and then go here into Edit Family. And it basically opens up that family, and as you can see, when I hover over it, it has this kind of a box around it. That's a telltale sign that this is an imported geometry. And if we go ahead and select this tree again inside of the family, here in the properties, it's going to say import symbol A underscore tree 35.dwg. So .dwg is of course the extension for AutoCAD files. So this is originally an AutoCAD tree modeled in AutoCAD, and then it was loaded in Revit. That's why it has a lot of, that's why it's going to slow it down a lot. So unless it was modeled using Revit tools like this and saved, if it was imported like this, it's going to slow down the model. Also here, if I go, let me just close this off. Nope. Okay, this car as well, if we take a look at it, it looks cool. It's the Ferrari California. Who doesn't love that car? But as you can see, from these lines here, this mesh, this is something that doesn't belong in Revit. And again, if we select it and go into Edit Family, you're going to notice again that if we select it, it has that box around it, and here in the name it says .dwg, so this was also modeled in AutoCAD or maybe 3ds Max or something like that, and then it was imported into Revit. So that's just a telltale sign if a family is made using like native Revit geometry like extrusions, blends, sweeps, or if it was modeled in some different piece of software. Okay, the next thing that's also going to slow your Revit project down is over-constraining your model. So when people find out that they can kind of add constraints to the model, they really like it and they tend to over-constrain their project. So for example, here you have some walls, and then you select the wall and then you go here and you pin it in place so you can never move it, or you do something like that, or whenever you're aligning something, you lock it in place so it moves along with it. It's really useful to kind of lock and align things, but don't overdo it. If it's necessary for the design, if it's going to maybe have some design changes in that area of a building, then you can maybe, I don't know, so for example, if you have some elements here, so if you add, let's say, a window on this part of the wall and then a window here, and if you want those two windows to be aligned and that's something that's really important to the design, then go ahead and go into the Align tool, so just here, and then just go ahead, align it and lock it in place. But don't overdo it. Don't do it if it's not necessarily important for a change. You can also like select the walls and then go attach top base and select the roof, so in case you change maybe the position of the roof, if you give it an offset and you change the roof height, the walls are going to move with the roof, but any additional unnecessary locking or pinning in place, it's going to significantly slow down your model. Moving on, and the last one is using in-place modeling instead of component modeling. So for families in Revit, when I go here to Architecture and we have this component option, when I open up the drop menu, we have an option to place a component or to model in place. So place a component basically allows you to place any of the families that are loaded in, for example, like this table here, this desk. Okay, but if you, let's say, want to add some sort of a box on this table or desk, you would go and what you can do as an option, and what I see people doing as a mistake, is modeling it in place. So you see the desk here inside of the model, so you go, okay, I'm going to model something in place, and then you go and you go and you say, okay, that will be furniture, and then you go with furniture one and everything grays out, and now you have all of your tools for creating families. And now you would go just for an extrusion, perhaps set the work plane here and place it here on top, and then just do your simple box just like that, finish it off, finish model, and there we go. So now we have that box model. But the problem with this is that this is now a family that's only connected to this here place. So if you want to copy it, it's going to give you all sorts of trouble. If you start to kind of change that or something like that, it's not going to change the original family, things like that, and you're going to have problems. And also, this family is only inside of this project. It cannot be used in other projects, or you have to copy it or something like that. So whenever you're using families, make sure you go ahead, and if you want to create a box family, go to file, take the extra step, go here to new, go to family, and then you can go and create your like generic or like furniture family. And here then you create your box. Let's do the box. Okay, who cares? Load it into the project and then place your box over here. And just now I made that mistake that I said in the beginning, and that's I left it named family two. So again, don't make this mistake. I'm just in a hurry to complete this tutorial, but don't do things like this. So four families, model them separately unless they are all a part of your project. So the only situation where you would model families and as in-place elements is, for example, if you want to have some, I don't know, facade element that goes here. So then you would go to, I don't know, component, model in place, and you want to attach it to some of your geometry. So I can go here to generic models, and then I can go maybe to a sweep, and then go with pick path, and then pick 3D edges, and then I can pick these lines like this, I don't know, like that, and then here I can make a sweep that goes along the top of this. Finish, and then I can go into edit profile, and as you can see now we can make a profile that's kind of following the contour of this building. So this is cool to make as an in-place family, something like this. But anything else that can be reused in any other projects or copied around, I really suggest you go ahead and go here to file, new, and then go to family and create a new family. Okay, so those are the five most common mistakes that I see people make in Revit. So just make sure you don't make them when working on your own projects. Now, if you're looking for some more advanced Revit courses, I have a Patreon, first a link in the description of this video, and there one of the tiers that you can subscribe to is the advanced courses tier. So you have a lot of these advanced courses. I've got like 33 courses out so far, so that's over 33 hours of content, and I just tackle numerous advanced Revit topics and explain them in detail. The 1 hour like course format gives me time to kind of go in depth and completely explain each topic. And if you're interested in something like that, check it out. First link in the description. Also, there you can find all of my Revit project files that I create for these tutorials. I have over 300 or 400 files out there so far. Okay, so that concludes this quick little 5 most common mistakes. And yeah, one more thing, you can get one-on-one tutoring so I can help you with your own projects. So again, if that's something you're interested, first link in the description, there you can contact me. Okay, so that covers this quick tutorial. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in a few days with another Balkan Architect tutorial. Have a nice day.